10 hut! Join the battle with your U.S. Army World War II uniform hoodie, featuring a fully detachable helmet hood with chin straps, separate ammunition pouches, and metal buckles. Built from quality materials, this hoodie will not let you down in the combat terrain on the Western Front of World War II. This unique hoodie will be available for 2 weeks only. Click the link in the description below. Go, go, go!
Uniform of the American G.I. on D-Day. June 6, 1944. From the outbreak of the Second World War, the U.S. Armed Forces started to actively prepare for what they saw as their inevitable entry into the conflict. Nevertheless, they were still relatively ill-prepared when they were finally drawn into the war on December 7, 1941, following the surprise attack by the Japanese on the U.S. naval base at Pearl Harbor. The U.S. immediately found themselves up against the combined might of the Axis powers, which consisted of Nazi Germany, Japan, and Italy. In order to fight this conflict effectively, the Americans rapidly developed a whole new generation of highly effective weapons that included the M4 Sherman tank and the B-17 Flying Fortress bomber. As a matter of urgency, the U.S. Army Infantry, commonly called GIs, which stood for Government Issue or General Issue, had their World War I era M1917 Doughboy helmet and Springfield M1903 bolt-action rifle quickly replaced with the newer M1 steel helmet and M1 Garand rifle. This new steel helmet gave much better head protection, and the M1 Garand was a semi-automatic rifle, which allowed for more rapid and accurate firing. So, when in the summer of 1944 it came time for the Allies to retake Europe from the Germans, the US GIs were now well-equipped and highly motivated soldiers. Their combat uniform now started to include the US Army's new olive-colored M1943-issued battle dress, which was made of special densely woven cotton sateen that was both windproof and extremely water-resistant. Soldiers were also issued the M43 double-buckle combat boots, which had better ankle protection and did away with the need for canvas ankle gaiters that had been around for the previous couple of centuries. Due to supply problems with the new uniform, however, most units fighting in France didn't get theirs until the autumn of 1944, well after the Normandy landings. This, and the fact that the military wanted to use up all of the existing uniform supplies first, meant that most U.S. infantry divisions assaulted the beaches designated Utah and Omaha in Normandy, wearing the old M41 combat jackets and rough-out boots with canvas gaiters. Though the majority of GIs carried the M1 Garand rifle, some were given the cumbersome M1918 BAR to be used as a squad's light machine gun. The ammo was normally carried in the 10 ammunition pouches on the standard-issue belts. The Garand used 30-06 caliber cartridges in 8-round N-block clips loaded into an internal magazine. When the last round was fired, the spent clips would be ejected and make an audible pinging sound. Each pouch could carry one clip, but more ammunition could be carried about his person or in the semi-waterproof backpack. Also found in the average soldier's backpack was his canteen, canteen cup, and mess kit, all of which were made of lightweight aluminum. These were packed alongside his food in the form of emergency D-ration high-energy chocolate bars for eating on the go, and the more nutritious K-field ration packs, which included gum, cigarettes, matches, and toilet paper. In addition to all of this, there was a useful barbed wire cutter and the all-important first aid kit, which contained a one-size-fits-all wounds Carlisle bandage that was impregnated with sulfa. On the outside were three pouches that each housed two hand grenades. Hanging from the back was an entrenching tool, which could also be used to great effect as a hand-to-hand combat weapon. Though the 10-inch bayonet that fixed on the end of the standard rifle also fulfilled this purpose, acting as a deadly combat knife in a pinch. Additionally, several further items were added to the GI's kit, especially for D-Day. First was an extremely handy set of books, one on French culture and the other a French-English dictionary. These were particularly useful as the average American soldier had never been out of his home state before, let alone to a distant country like France. A life preserver and a waterproof rifle bag were also supplied in case you were unlucky enough to have your landing craft sunk by enemy fire and end up in the freezing cold water of the English Channel. Though obviously these special issue countermeasures were quickly discarded once ashore on the beaches of Normandy. While this may seem like a lot of equipment and supplies for just one man to carry, during the Normandy landings in particular, it was more important than ever that the average US soldier was as self-sufficient as possible. This was due to the uncertainty as to when forward supply bases could be established efficiently. Once the beachhead was established and the Allied troops pushed further inland, they could leave behind these heavy backpacks and were able to more accurately tailor what they would carry for individual missions, raids, or patrols. One piece of kit generally left behind was the standard issue E-637 Army Assault Gas Mask, later renamed the M-5-11-7 Combat Service Mask. It was anticipated that there was a 1-in-3 chance that the Germans would use gas to protect the beachheads, but they never did. Incidentally, the waterproof carrier acted as an additional flotation aid to complement the life preserver because of it being strapped to the soldier's chest. Today, it's estimated that the average US soldier costs anywhere between $28,000 and $60,000 to equip, depending on their role and the theater that they're being deployed to. This cost is naturally ever increasing as modern equipment and high-tech innovations are applied to a soldier's loadout.